Design, and I'm the country manager for Turkey here at the University of Manchester. So I'm going to be talking to you about what it's like to live and study in Manchester. I'm going to run through a few slides in the first instance, and then if you would like to ask any questions at the end, then you're really welcome to do so. So in terms of what we're going to be covering in the slides, I will try to be as brief as possible. I know that there's, you know, lots of different presentations going on at the moment with lots of slides, so I'm hoping that today can be as interactive as possible. But basically, I'll talk you through some basic details about the university, where we're physically located, what you can study, etc. And then I'll talk about some of the elements of the university experience in Manchester outside of the classroom. So in terms of our physical location, first of all, so you can see here on the map that we are right in the middle of the UK, which from my own point of view makes it a really, really good base to explore the rest of the country, especially if you think about an undergraduate degree being between 3 and 5 years, depending on what you're going to be studying. You know, you've got holidays and weekends that you really want to make the most of the whole experience. So being based in Manchester allows you to get around the country, see a few different things. It's really, really conveniently located in terms of just being 2 hours away from London by train. We have our own large international airport, which is just 30 minutes from campus, which you can reach by either bus or train. And we are kind of considered the second city in the UK after London. So it's a very large cosmopolitan atmosphere. In terms of the university itself, it's also really conveniently located within the city. So you can see the city centre outlined in yellow here on the screen. And then you can see the university campus outlined in white. So this is actually just a short walk, only about 20 minutes, maybe 10 minutes on the bus. And the really nice thing I think about this particular setup is that when you're on campus, you really feel like you're at university. So you've got all of the beautiful buildings from the 1800s, as well as some of the more modern glass fronted architecture. And you have that kind of scholarly environment. You really feel like you're at university. And then you walk just 20 minutes and you're in one of the main cities in the UK. It's very cosmopolitan, very multicultural, lots of different things to see and do. So having that distinction and that chance to kind of switch off, maybe on an afternoon or a weekend, is something that our students tend to really like. So in terms of our courses, we're organised into three faculties here at the University of Manchester. So we've got a Faculty of Humanities, which includes our Alliance Manchester Business School. We also have our Faculty of Biology, Medicine and Health, and our Faculty of Science and Engineering too. And here on the screen, you can see just some of the examples of courses that you can study here at Manchester. This is by no means exhaustive. It is a very, very long list, which I couldn't possibly fit all on one PowerPoint, but it literally runs A to Z from anatomy through to zoology and all of the different kind of subject areas in between. There's over 400 different degree programs that you can study at the University of Manchester at undergraduate level, but hopefully this illustrates the breadth and the depth of what we offer as a university. To kind of further illustrate that point, the range and the scope of the university, I thought I would kind of quickly run you through some numbers. So we are one of the biggest universities in the UK. We've actually over 40,000 students, of which over 10,000 are international. We have an annual income of over £1 billion, and we've got various different kind of strengths in terms of things like research and spin out companies. And there's also been a very extensive investment in the physical campus of the university over the course of the last 10 years. So several new buildings have been built, several have been refurbished. There's been various different things that we've done on campus to make the atmosphere of studying more pleasant and enjoyable. So this kind of illustrates, I think, the scope of the university. In terms of what it's like to be a student, of course, the transition from school to university is a big one, no matter where you're coming from, whether that's somewhere else in the UK or from overseas. And that academic step up as well can also take some time to get used to. It will be a slightly different atmosphere to school in the sense that you may have more independence in your learning style. So we will expect you to be an independent learner from the outset of the course, and we'll expose you to challenging ideas, and we will expect you to take responsibility for your own learning. But equally, we also provide a lot of support, recognizing that it is always a transition from school to university. And we have lots of experience of providing that support. So for example, you will have a dedicated academic advisor for each of the years that you are studying your undergraduate degree. They will do things like help you choose your optional modules according to things like timetabling and availability and your own academic interests. You're also able to access peer support. So that might be, for example, assisted study sessions with an older student. We also make sure that our courses are industry relevant, that they're up to date. So although we are a very old university, our curriculum, our syllabi are all fit for the kind of modern world of work. And we do that by close relationships with employers. We also provide language support. So that can be both before you arrive for your university studies through a pre-sessional course, or it can also be in-sessional language support. And the in-sessional language support is completely free of charge. So that helps you to become more familiar with the kinds of English language skills that you will need to successfully study at undergraduate level. And if you go on to do a dissertation, which most students will do as part of their undergraduate degree, then you'll also have a dedicated dissertation supervisor. That's normally separate from your academic advisor. And this person is a specialist in the field that you are interested in writing your dissertation in. So you can see here lots of different kinds of support for the academic side of the experience. And I'll also talk you through a little bit about some of the other kinds of support that we offer later on in the presentation as well. So I mentioned that we will expose you to challenging ideas from the outset as part of your course. And what that really means in practice is that we will encourage you to read extensively, both from our kind of recommended reading list and also potentially from your own research. And in the classes that you have, the learning style may be relatively informal compared to what you're used to. So we'll encourage you to question, to analyse, to openly discuss ideas. In many cases, you're on first name terms with your lecturers and your professors. So this can be quite different sometimes from other academic backgrounds overseas. Because we are a research intensive university, the learning that you do, even at undergraduate level, will be have a really, really strong basis in research. So the research that we do as professionals working for the university informs the teaching that we offer to our undergraduate, our top master's students. And in many cases, you will be taught by some of the leading experts in the field that you are studying in that particular module. So some, you know, really well-known names within the world of academia. We'll also encourage you to develop your skills alongside the academic experience. So, you know, transferable skills that will be useful in the workplace going forward. And we'll do all of that in a variety of different ways. So various different teaching techniques, from that kind of more traditional laboratory-based work for example, science and engineering subjects, through to lectures, seminars, and e-learning. Obviously, e-learning has been a really significant part of the experience in the last two academic years, but actually even prior to the COVID pandemic, this was something that we already had a lot of experience of. It was already a core part of how we taught students at Manchester, even prior to all of this starting. One thing that we are particularly proud of at the university is our careers service. So this is an offering to students that they can access from the very first day at Manchester through to up to 2 years after they graduate. And it offers all of the kind of traditional services that you might expect, things like CV checks, interview preparation, career planning and advising, through to some more kind of recent introductions, maybe over the last few years, things like career mentoring, the Manchester Global Network, etc., as well as a variety of subject specific careers fairs. We can help with either internships as part of your course or maybe internships and graduate schemes after graduation. And you can see here on the screen the typical starting salary for some of our graduates after they've left us. And one kind of way to evidence the engagement that we have through the career service is the fact that we were in 2020 the most targeted university by the largest number of top employers. And you can see some of those employers here on the screen. So they are a mix of local, national, and international companies. So that kind of evidences the employers that we engage with on a regular basis. Continue with the theme of graduate employability. The majority of our graduates, 94%, are in either employment or further study within 6 months of graduation. Last year we were the most targeted university. This year we are the second most targeted university. This should be 2021. And at the moment we are fifth in the UK for graduate employability according to the QS rankings as well. Another aspect of employability is the things that you are involved in outside of the classroom. So often when you are talking to employers about your university experience, as well as telling them the modules that you have studied and the grades that you have received, you'll also be talking about some of the things that you have been involved in terms of, for example, societies and sports clubs, volunteering, and the university recognises the contribution that you make through those activities through something called Stellify. So Stellify literally means to change or be changed into a star in English, and it is a formal recognition alongside your degree, certificate and your transcript of studies of the extra or co-curricular activities that you have been involved in as part of your Manchester experience. And that can be really helpful when you are talking to employers, because it is something tangible that you can take to them and show how you've been involved in university life. Another thing that students are often interested in is the opportunity to expand their studies beyond their kind of core content of their degree. And one way that they can do that is through our University College of Interdisciplinary Learning, or USIL. So what this allows you to do is swap out one of your optional modules in, for example, second year, for something that is not related to the subject that you are currently studying. So for example, you could be studying something like politics or business, and you could take a module to do with artificial intelligence. You could learn language, you could do a history module. So that kind of allows you to broaden your learning experience, to engage in a different subject for, you know, one of your for optional modules. And it's a really popular thing to do at the university. Another way that we help you to support your skills is through a programme of ethical grand challenges. So these take place in each of the 3 core years of your undergraduate degree. So in the first year, you will get involved in our sustainability grand challenge. This is something that you undertake at the very beginning of your first year. It's related to one of our kind of core goals. And it's a really nice way also, just from a purely practical perspective, of making friends outside of the classroom and helping you to become familiar with that university environment. In your second year, we will ask you to get involved in the social justice challenge. And in the third year, we'll start looking ahead to the world of work by encouraging you to get involved in the final grand challenge in your third year. Another thing that we are really proud of at the university is the impact rankings. So in the inaugural ranking, we were first in the UK and third in the world. And actually it was released, I think, only last week that we are now first in the UK and also first in the world. So this is something that we're really, really excited about, really proud of. I think evidence is the work that the university does and how that can be, you know, really transformative outside of the university environment too. So moving on now to talk about some of the things that you might want to get involved in your spare time. Sport is a massive part of who we are, both as a university and as a city in Manchester. And we also have really good facilities for a wide range of sports. You can see here on the screen some of the facilities that we're able to offer to students, either based on campus or based in our halls of residence. So pretty much no matter what the sport that you are interested in, we will be able to offer you opportunities to both train and compete if that is what you're interested in that sport. The home of both our societies and our sports clubs is the student union, and there's over 400 different societies available. So they may be country related societies, for example, so getting a kind of a taste of home, if you like, while you're studying here. It might also be something to do with your degree through our subject related societies, and there's a society for most subjects already in existence. It's a really nice way, again, to meet students outside of the classes that you are directly involved in. Maybe they're older students, or maybe they're taking different modules from you. And then there's also a range of kind of recreational and hobby societies and societies to do with employability and future careers. And then finally, it's also the home for our media, student media, so our newspaper, the Mancunian, and our radio and TV channels, Views. So I mentioned earlier that I'd tell you a little bit more about some of the support services that we offer at the university. So these are things that we offer outside of the classroom, maybe slightly separate to the core academic support that we offer, but that students can take advantage of it at any stage of their degree. So for example, we have a dedicated immigration team who can help with student visas and also provide advice on things like the graduate immigration route. We offer a confidential counselling service. We're also able to help with money management and advice. There's a dedicated disability support team. And all of our university residences have something called a residential life team based in the residences themselves. So this is the kind of idea, you may be more familiar with the idea of like a warden, for example. So it's an older student or a member of staff who's there to provide pastoral and practical support outside of the core working office hours of the university. You have your academic advisor, as we've already discussed. You have support from the students' union. So they're not only there to offer kind of sports clubs and societies, for example, they're also there to represent your interests as a student, and you can get involved in that as well through being, for example, a classroom rep or being involved in some committees. And you also have the free and sessional English language support through the University Language Centre. So the accommodation that we offer to students, as a student based outside the UK, you will be guaranteed accommodation for the duration of your studies. In practice, most students choose to live in halls in first year, and then maybe from second year onwards, they might go into private accommodation with friends from their course or hobbies and interests. But we have over 8,000 rooms at the university. So as long as you have applied before the deadline, which is normally in August, then you will be guaranteed a room in university managed accommodation if you would like to have that. It isn't obligatory, but it's something that most students tend to do because it makes a really nice transition from kind of, you know, living at home with family to becoming truly independent, perhaps for the first time. So the kinds of support that we're able to offer make that transition as smooth as possible. So included in your rent is all of your utility bills, so heat, electricity, internet, so on and so forth, a basic level of insurance. And you can also choose between self-catered accommodation, where you're cooking for yourself the whole time, through to a kind of a meal plan, which is normally breakfast and dinner. All of the halls have their own sports and recreational facilities. They also have the residential life team that I've already mentioned. And they also organise their own social activities through something called either junior common room or residence association. So they might organise, for example, like a movie night or a scavenger hunt to kind of help you settle in those first few weeks of university, but also to help you keep in touch with the people that you're living with throughout the course of the year. In terms of the facilities, you can choose between ensuite bathroom or shared bathroom facilities. I've already mentioned that you can either have self-catered or catered accommodation. We have 22 different halls here at the University of Manchester in three different areas, which I'll show you on the map in a second. We also offer a housing advice service. So if you do decide to go into private accommodation after your first year, then we can help you with things like tenancy check. We have a database of registered landlords who have a good reputation of renting to students. So that kind of, you know, next step in the journey is also supported as well. So you can see here on the map our different accommodation areas. So the black dots are the main part of the university campus. And then we've got city accommodation in these purple circles. So it's very close to both the campus and the city centre of Manchester. You have rooms in an area called Victoria Park. So this is a really leafy, green, pretty part of Manchester, and only a short walk to the university campus. And then finally, you've got Fallowfield in orange. So Fallowfield is a little bit further away. It's about a 30-minute walk, or maybe sort of 15, 20 minutes on the bus or cycling. But I always describe Valleyfield as a bit of a student village. So it's got its own shops, bars, restaurants, kind of social scene. It's really, really popular with first year students and popular with both home students and international students as well. So really nice mix and really conveniently located for studying still. So that kind of brings me to the end of the formal presentation. So I've got just, you know, a few pictures of what normal life in Manchester is like playing on the screen. I can see that there's one message come in the chat so far, but if you have any other questions, oh, it's just Alper saying to ask your questions. But yeah, if you have any questions, then please do pop them in the chat. You can either message me them privately or Alper, if you prefer to write in Turkish, that's absolutely fine. And you can kind of let us know the things that you would, you know, you would need to research as part of your kind of UCAS journey or anything else that you would like to know.
Caroline, can you tell us a bit more about the industrial placement year? How do you manage it?
Of course. So a lot of our degrees will offer an option which is either called industrial experience or sometimes professional experience. And effectively, this is an internship year. So this is extending your degree normally from 3 years to four. So you have 2 years in Manchester, then you go out and do your industrial experience or your professional experience. And that can be in Manchester, it can be somewhere else in the UK, it can be overseas. And then you'll come back to Manchester for your honours year and you'll graduate after that. So in terms of how that works in practice, you can either use support offered by the university to help you find a placement. So it's not guaranteed. You do have to apply to the companies yourself with your CV and cover letter, for example. But we can kind of tell you the employers who've taken our students in the past. We can help you, you know, search vacancies, or you can use your own connections. So if, for example, you wanted to come back to Turkey to do a year's work experience and you had connections that could help you do that, then that would also be an option. Where you're sourcing your own placement, you have to have it approved by the university. So we need to know that it's going to be a good quality experience, which is going to enhance your degree. So there are certain criteria that need to be met. But basically, you have both options. So you have the option to kind of source your placement through us as the university or to source your own. And that experience, that, you know, sort of between 6 and 12 months of real life working experience can really add to your overall employability. So it can teach you some really valuable skills. In many cases, it can lead to an offer of a job after you graduate. But even if it doesn't, it's still a year's worth of practical experience on your CV that you can then talk to future employers about as well.
Can a student select to study with industrial placement year after he or she started?
Yes, in most cases. So those years do have their own UCAS codes. So if you know that it is definitely something that you want to do, then you can apply for that from the outset. But in the majority of cases, it is also possible to transfer on to that route once you've already started studying. You need to have good grades, so it's really important to study hard. So you need to maintain a 60% plus average for the majority of courses. But yes, you will be, you know, we'll send you an email at a certain point in first year and ask if anyone is interested in transferring on to this route. And if you are, you can express an interest by responding to that email. And as long as your grades are sufficient, then you can kind of move on to that route once you've already started studying.
Thank you so much.